Welcome to Chasing Limits on Shaw TV. We're here at Wind Sports Canada Olympic Park with a freestyle NORAM slope-style skiing competition. My name is Paul Stutz, and joining me is Kevin Kwasny.
It's always a pleasure to be here at COP. Look at that view of the mountains.
We obviously have an amazing competition on deck for us today. These are some of the best male slope-style skiers in the world, even at this NORAM level.
We have some great skiers from all over Canada, U.S., just coming really with some great, great tricks.
But we got some of the hometown heroes obviously going to be showing us how it's done using their experience training and competing at Windsport, and see if that home field advantage will pay off against some of these Americans.
Nice look at our leaderboard from our first two runs. We're coming into our final run of the day.
So it's best of three format. It's one run takes all, and they have three shots at putting their best tricks and their best flow from start to finish down. And you can see top scores going into the final round, but now's where it's, the pressure's going to come into place. This is for all the marbles here in the final round.
Yeah, and first up we have Dean Berkovich, a team member of Team Canada, skiing out of Whistler, spends a lot of time on the trampoline, always working on his big tricks.
The 23-year-old Whistler, he's got the full package. He's got the experience. We know he's got the skills to put him in the finals, but it's all about what he can come up with, what tricks he's going to bring out, and what the judges like to see, right?
We are going to see him come through this course, and it's overall impression for the judges. He's got to impress them on all three of the rails and all three of the jumps.
So we got six different features that they'll all be able to hit. They're going to be using different spinning maneuvers, different directions going off, and creativity is really going to come into play to see what they can come up with here.
And that's huge. We just saw Dean go from the flat bar to the opposite down rail, and that's using the whole course. He could have just went straight to the regular down rail from that flat bar. 2-7 onto the down rail, coming into the first jump with a big 900.
Obviously a new addition to the world of skiing to really see and these competitors sliding on the rails and doing what they can in the park, but amazing how big these jumps are at the bottom. It's a lot more than you can imagine. You just saw a tremendous run from Dean Berkovich because he really, really sent it and went big off that last hit.
Yeah, the second hit was his big double. I think this is the this is our first replay of the 900 coming into the switch double. So he's hitting that jump backwards and doing two full flips. And look at that. He holds the grab the entire time.
That's what the judges are looking for. Obviously, referring to doubles as double flips and 900 spinning that many degrees. So they're actually landing backwards, taking off backwards. So all of that switch reference will be exactly what the judges want to see, and the versatility is going to go along with it.
And a 1260 on that bottom air, 3.5 full rotations. That is a lot of spinning.
Pretty much as top tier as this sport gets. I mean, we're at a NORAM level here, but those are all World Cup and Olympic level tricks that we've seen in previous years. And a lot of the athletes we're going to be seeing today are going to have that future of those Olympic dreams, those X Games dreams, those top tier competitions that they are all working their way up to.
Yeah, we would probably see a few more doubles in the World Cup or the Olympic level, but right now we're seeing some huge tricks from some amazing skiers. Even a single double in a run was unheard of even a few years ago. 72.58, so that's an improvement from his first standing score.
Going to be happy with that. He'll be taking that as his final score through the evening, but he's just our first of 16 skiers in the men's final.
Having a time at the bottom of the hill.
It's all about fun. I mean, skiing is a family for all of them. They, of course, they're competitors when it comes down to their run, but they're going to train together, compete together, and build off each other. They're going to be enjoying the process start to finish, because at the end of the day, it's still just a fun day out in the mountain skiing.
Sam McCowan off our Alberta team here at COP, dropping in. So he gets to choose from a flat down rail or the down rail. He chooses the flat down, comes off a little bit early, heads into that pyramid rail. 450 out, coming in switch to the teardrop. Switch 270 on to straight out. Solid rail game.
Many different features they can choose from. So the creativity in your line is exactly what's going to be able to play to the judges. You can choose which rails you're hitting and which ones are to your strengths. But those three big jumps at the bottom are going to be the ones that are really going to show off their stuff for the judges.
And just can't quite put the double cork to his feet.
Missing the bottom jump, obviously, by not completing the landing on the middle hit. But you know what? That's okay. He's got some other runs under his belt, and he knows that mistake might cost him a spot at the top of the leaderboard today. But you know what? He's going to build off that.
Yeah, if you don't land each one of these perfectly, you're going to lose speed. And on a jump this size, you have to have the perfect speed to make it to the perfect landing. You see those blue lines? They're all shooting for that sweet spot.
And when you're judged on overall impression, missing a feature is definitely going to cost you.
It's going to cost you huge. That means you didn't complete your run. That overall is just not what they're looking for.
But you can just see the height that McCowan is taking. It almost looks like he's over the height of the chairlifts, and he really is. I mean, that's how big these jumps are, but how much they're sending it and how big those tricks really are.
So his first score will stand for the day. He'll end with a 57.91. He'll want to improve on that for his next competition, but he'll train here at COP and keep getting better.
Still a solid score. Great to see. Back to the start, Freddie Brickweiser, 21-year-old out of USA.
Has his coach up there with his camera so he can do some video review later.
Sorry, I read that wrong. Brickweiser, I guess it's pronounced.
Dropping into that flat bar. Oh, elects to go just to the down rail, 270 on, into the pyramid, 270 in, and 270 out. So he's spinning almost a full rotation in and out. Oh, 450 out of the teardrop.
Freddie's definitely the full package for the extreme sport athlete. He's big into surfing as well as motocross. But you know what? This is where he comes to shine on the slopestyle course.
Starts off with a right side 900 into a left side switch 900. He had a very big mute grab into a final hit of 900 tail grab. So great. 900 is 2.5 full rotations.
Great to see landing switch off that last hit. I think he'll be happy with that. Try to build off those scores from his first two rounds. But you know what? A complete solid run there, using the creativity, but going big when it counts too.
Yeah, he didn't have the double like our two previous competitors, but he did have some good style and some solid landings. You can see the flex on those skis. He's coming down with a lot of pressure.
Equipment's going to be so important, not just to match the snow conditions, but they want to have their setups completely dialed in. Skis are made so well nowadays with twin tip construction, but the strength and rigidity to handle not just the rails, but the landings off of these massive jumps.
Yeah, you can see that there's snow guns put right into the COP park just to build these big of jumps.
It's an awful lot of snow and a lot of preparation that goes into creating this, but Windsport, as we saw in the half pipe, has a world-class facility. They really have stepped their game up and invested a lot of money into providing a world-class destination for freestyle skiing and snowboarding.
Freddie, with a huge improvement from his first run, his 46.5 is now a 72.16.
72.16 puts him in the mix. That's great to see.
Mitchell Wilson, a BC team member at the top, trains out of Whistler, so he's used to some very big jumps.
Also strong in the halfpipe event, but looks like being in the final of slopestyle here, he's going to use that confidence from the halfpipe and the success there and do some great runs. Awesome start with a 180 off that rail.
Coming into the flat down, very nice 270 on, coming in switch into his first hit. You can see that you got to stay in control through all this slushy snow.
Weather's been so mild in Calgary lately. A lot of effort has gone into hill preparation to make sure it's not only a fair competition, but a safe one. And a huge double flip off the bottom.
Coming into his final hit. Spins a left side 900 with the stale fish.
I think he was showing the judges that he has all the tricks in his bag. Switch off those both two bottom hits. Definitely happy with his performance there. Let's see if the judges agree. He wants to build off that 58.16 from before.
Again, those big doubles we're going to be seeing today.
It just shows the level these athletes have pushed themselves to. All the off-season training, the trampolines, the water pits, the airbags. They're using all the new technology to be able to up their game and start throwing tricks that are that big when even the snow's not flying. They're able to be improving their sport.
Yeah, unlike last night, we see lenses that aren't clear. These guys have to deal with, you can see that gray cloud in the background. That's going to cause some confusion in between the sky and the ground, and these guys are going upside down twice. They need to really be able to see when those blue lines are coming.
And that's the thing. Those blue lines are definitely not there for anything as far technically. It's strictly for the skiers to be able to pinpoint their landing, be able to see the jumps and the takeoffs. When the visibility's not there, it keeps it safe, but as well fair.
Nice view of our judges. So in a big course like this, we have to have a split panel. We'll have some judges watching the jumps and some judges watching the rails. So that was a view of our rail judges up there. 77.16. Another great improvement from his first two runs.
It's great to see these skiers stepping it up in the third round when the pressure's on, but a lot of them are having their best run, even in the finals.
Yeah, they've tested the conditions. They know what they need to do now. So we have Brendan Reed coming up. He scored a 73.91 in his first run, and now he's getting ready to put down his final run of the day.
Brendan Reed's a Whistler hero, but a member of our Canadian ski team, and he's going to be seeing what he can do here in Calgary.
So 270 on one direction, 270 out the other. Catches a little bit of the slough in there. Switch up on the rail to 270 out.
Didn't seem to hold him back. He is no stranger to the rails, obviously showing the skills he's built there, probably at the park in Whistler.
Spinning in and out is what the judges want to see. Now coming in with a carving 900 tail grab into switch double nine. That's pretty big.
Awesome hit off there, and loses a ski off the takeoff. And goes down hard. That is not what we want to see, but it just shows how much they're pushing themselves. They're chasing those limits to be on top. And unfortunately, this is the ugly side of the sport, but just shows how competitive it is and how much they're risking themselves to be on top.
And how important these guys, our ski patrol, are. We couldn't hold an event without ski patrol. They keep all of us safe, and if something happens, they're the first responders to be there.
Safety is obviously very important. Helmets are mandatory, and as you can see there, can be the difference between saving your day and ending up back to race again or compete again tomorrow, or taking a little trip to the hospital. All of these athletes are going to have some injuries in their past, but you know, it's we never like to see it in competition.
No, and helmets are mandatory not just in competition, but in the park for everyday skiers. You can see on our right up there that there are kids coming in and out of those rails and of those jumps.
Glad to see Reed's getting attended to here. You can see him moving around, although definitely going to be a little banged up after crashing that hard coming down. It looks like his ski came off as he was taking off, so that's probably where things started to go wrong.
The amount of torque he was putting on his bindings coming in, he was setting up for a big, big trick. And when you preload like that, your bindings sometimes, it's scary, but they sometimes like to give out on you. You got to have those dins cranked up when you're skiing that at this level.
It's so important to have your bindings set so they come off when necessary, but in a situation like this, came off at a time when he certainly didn't want them to, and resulted in a pretty ugly crash.
Yeah, he came down pretty hard and got some whip off that, and these landings are solid.
Looking at his rap sheet of injuries from before, he's definitely suffered a lot of knee problems and shoulder problems in his career, but you know what? He's 22. He's by no means one of the younger athletes, but he's still got a long career ahead of him, so it's tough to see some of those bad crashes, and hopefully nothing serious today.
switch double very deep in the land and coming in, and this is where things go wrong. You see that green base flying through the air. You want to have both skis on your feet when you're doing a double flip.
So he knows that he's in trouble the second that ski comes off. He actually tried to land it the best he possibly could. So it just shows he's a tremendous athlete, doing the best he could to minimize the risk. But he knew he was in trouble the second that ski came off.
And we're back at the top, seeing some grommets getting their first turns in, it looks like.
That's the next generation of slopestyle skiers right there. And as you know, Windsport's a very family-oriented facility. We have tremendous opportunity for snow sports in Alberta with all the ski resorts in the mountains. And that's what it takes. Those young skiers are going to be looking at some of these competitors on the world stage here. And glad to see Brendan Reed on his feet. Looks to be in one piece. That's a tough crash, and he'll be feeling that later. But luckily, he's going to be able to make his own way down the mountain.
His coach got down there very quickly. Those coaches and athletes have great connections, and that worries a coach. Anytime an athlete goes down, that's always on your mind.
It's part of the game. He'll be taking a good look at his equipment there to see exactly what went wrong, and be able to clean that up for next week. But by the looks of how things are going for Reed, he'll be back to compete again next weekend.
So his first score of 73.9 will be the one that stands, that's for sure. He'll have a little bit of a headache, I think, and hopefully come back and ski just as hard.
That's the benefit of a three-run competition. He's actually still in the mix with a solid score still from his other runs, but he luckily this happened in his third and final run.
All right, back at the top, we have another Canadian competitor from the BC team, Luke Smart.
Luke Smart, also out of Whistler, 16-year-old, so a young skier on the circuit, but no issues with experience here. He's going to use all of that Whistler ingenuity and style that we've seen from those West Coasters, and if he can bring that to the top of the podium here today in Calgary, that'd be great to see.
Nice switch up on the rail to 270 out. Goes to the flat bar, switch on, another switch up, switch out of that rail, coming into the flat down, 270 on, continuous two on the rail. So he continues spinning once he landed on that rail.
Great to see the options they have for the rails. But you know what? A lot of people seem to be sticking with that flat deck.
Yeah, and switch off that first jump into a switch nine, into a big 900 the other direction, showing those judges he can spin both ways.
Which is so important and so hard. As you said before, it's like writing with your opposite hand. It's so counterintuitive to be able to spin in the opposite direction, and not just once. We're talking two, three times here.
It's great to see these younger athletes learning and training that spinning. That wasn't a thing back in the day. You spun your one natural direction, and that's all you needed. Now, to woo these judges, you got to go left and right, switch left, switch right. We saw that the 16-year-old doesn't have the doubles that some of the older competitors have, but he had some very styly big spins.
Great to see those big spins. And you know what? Those doubles, maybe they're in the back of his mind, and he knows that's the next step for him. And being 16, he's got a long future ahead of him.
And Whistler's lucky. They have a water ramp facility where he can be training all summer long, working on those doubles on the trampoline and on the water to do them safely on these big jumps.
Which is a great opportunity. Water ramps, airbags, where if things go wrong midair, as we just saw with that last crash, you're safe.
71.58. So his first run will stand. All right, Nathan at the top.
Nathan Maselli out of the USA, skis for Team Park City United out of Park City, Utah, 18-year-old.
So his first two runs had a score of 19.41, so he's hoping to keep it on his feet for this final third and final run.
So he's obviously struggled with some attrition in these first two runs. He's had a few crashes, few mistakes, but you know what? He's got one more chance. See if he can bring it.
270 onto the down bar, into the pyramid rail. Straight on, 450 out. Coming in switch into the flat down. 270 on, a little early off that that rail. Coming in straight to that first jump.
A lot of speed going into that first hit.
Cork 900 off there, big tail grab. Into switch 900, spinning the opposite direction.
Shows that he has that full bag of tricks. That's what the judges want to see.
Into a left 900 with, again, a nice grab on it. So doesn't have the double, but again, a solid spinning run both directions. A little early off the rails. That might hurt him in the judges' eyes, but strong airs for him.
And three variations of the 900. It shows that he has all of those capabilities and those skills that the judges are looking for, because that just ups the degree of difficulty on each one of those jumps.
Yeah, the judges want to see different grabs, different spins, and different levels of invert. So whether he's going all the way upside down, or you can see that he's off axis on that one. Look at the flex on those skis.
Yeah, he came up a little bit short, didn't really land in the sweet spot there, but kept his speed up and was able to take the second hit and get the height he was looking for.
He had a Japan grab on that bottom one to counteract the tail grab that he did on the first nine. To see the variation.
Always got interesting names for the grabs. That's really cool to see.
So Nate's waiting on his score. Hopefully it's better than his 19.41, which I'm sure it is.
I'm sure it will be, off obviously having some struggles in his first two rounds. He'll be in the mix now with a solid run.
You can see all those recreational skiers getting an awesome show from the chairlift. This course is right beside the chairlift.
That would be the best seat in the house, to be able to ride up the chair and see these competitors in the air at the same height you're at on the chairlift, but knowing that they're upside down in the middle of a double flip or a 900 spin. 57.91 for Maselli.
You can almost high-five a competitor as they fly by on the chairlift. So Patrick Dew, his first run was a 63.5, second run a 72, so he's been getting better every run.
Getting better as he goes. We'll see if he can keep that trend and get himself up into the 80s for this next round on his third and final run here in the finals.
BC's Park and Pipe team coming into the down rail, 270 on, into the pyramid, straight on, 270 out, coming in switch. To the teardrop, switch 270 on to 270 out.
Dew skis at Silver Star outside Vernon in the Okanagan. It's a great freestyle community of skiing in the interior of BC. So he's got good company and great facilities to be training and competing in.
Big double off that second jump. Takes it to the third line almost. Nice 900 tail grab to finish things off.
He went big on all three of those jumps. That's exactly what we want to see. He was just sending it, and I think that will pay off, throwing the double in the mix, and he's got all of the difficult tricks in his repertoire.
When it comes down to it, you got to wow those judges, and doubles are going to be the way to do it. You can see he kind of not quite as tight as you'd like to see him on that first jump, but that double he pulls around very nicely.
And he's had some success. He's got two silver medals, both in the Aspen Big Air Open, but in the Dew Tour as well, but seems to be chasing that top spot on the podium. So he's going to be looking for that gold medal one of these days soon, and we'll be able to see if that's today when we get the scores from the judges.
He has the goal of making that national development team, skiing up with the maple leaf on his ski jacket. It's like the hockey jersey. We all want to represent Canada.
That's what it's all about, representing your country around the world, skiing, doing what you love, but making your country proud in the process.
Waiting on that score from those judges. That split panel now talking about where everything was, how those rails were, how those jumps were. And his second score will stand with a 72.
Which is keeping him in the mix. Great score, great day for Patrick Dew. Let's hear it for him, everybody, Patrick
Dew. Back up at the top now, we have Ryan McKellum out of Park City.
Another American, obviously taking advantage of the NORAM circuit, getting all those valuable NORAM points as they travel around. Important, not just each individual competition, but the season in general, as it is a whole tour, and those points at the end of the season matter.
Oh, yeah. It's how you get on to national teams. It's how you make it into the World Cup. And it's how, with these AFP points, you get into the big show like the X Games.
So, which is where they all want to be. They all have those X Games dreams, those World Cup and Olympic dreams. They're just chasing themselves and pushing their competitors to continue to evolve, grow the sport, but improve themselves to be able to make that next level.
Ryan had a pretty solid rail game up there. Came a little early off that second flat bar and switch into that first hit. Nice big switch, 720. Spinning the other way into a switch double 900 and into the final money jump. Big 900 tail grab. I think the 900 and the double is going to be the staple to what we're seeing today.
You can see a great angle there of just how much height he has. But you know what? Very smooth landings. He seemed a little bit tentative on the takeoff and a couple of those jumps, but landing smooth and keeping his speed and momentum, and no stranger to the big tricks.
This double right here, you can see that he's grabbing it out his boots, pulling himself around. That's what judges want to see. They want to see those grabs.
So he's had a couple scores in the 60s, 66 and a 68 from his first two runs. He's going to want to be moving up into the 70s to stay in the mix and be on the front page of that results sheet at the end of the day.
Paid off so much.
Yep. Chatting with our great volunteers at the bottom, wrangling all these crazy freestyle skiers.
Volunteers are a huge part of any of these sports, all winter sports, all sports in general. It truly is a family affair, and it's amazing to see how the volunteers have come out and really supported not just this sport, but everything that Alberta has to offer.
So 68.91 is the score that'll stand for him, his second run. Up next, another Canadian team member, Taylor Wilson, who scored an 82.3 in his last run. So he's one of the ones we are here to watch. He's going to put on a show.
82.33, one of the best scores we've seen. He made some mistakes in his first round, but you know what? His second run was exactly where he wanted to be, and he might even be able to improve on that. And with rails like that, he seems very comfortable, very smooth, using that teardrop, but just straight airs, not doing any of the exciting spins or anything off the side. So maybe he's going to step that up when he hits the jumps down at the bottom.
Yeah, he was very smooth on those rails, but didn't have the difficulty. Now just a straight backflip off that first air. I think he's taking this run kind of easy right now.
He knows he has that 82.33 in the bag, and he's just taking this as almost a... not necessarily a victory lap, because anything can happen, but he knows he's got that good one and taking this one easy.
That was a fun run for him, but it wasn't one of the competitive runs, that's for sure. Big smile on his face, though. After three big backflips, you can't help but smile.
Exactly. He just used that as an enjoyable round for him, and that's what it's all about. He's smiling. He's having a good day. It's just another day of skiing for him. Almost seems that even at this high level of competition, they're still out just having a fun day of skiing with their buddies.
Oh, there's no point to be on a cold hill if it's not fun.
And it certainly looks like it. But, wow, look at the height. Even on his kind of enjoyable run, his fun victory lap there, he's really enjoying himself and going big.
Yeah, that big banana backflip, as they call it.
One of the more traditional moves, not the new school off axis, but he's going to stick with that 82.33, which is a phenomenal score, and we'll keep him near the top of the leaderboard, but we still have some of the best skiers to go, so it's not over yet.
Big smiles, though. Big smiles.
Back to the start, Joe Lehner. Sorry, Joseph Lauer, actually, out of the U.S. is another athlete with the last name Lehner. I was getting them mixed up. But Joe Lauer from the U.S., 18 years old. He's had a successful day so far with a solid score in his first round. But you know what? He wants to step it up to be able to make the top of the leaderboard there.
So 270 on, 270 off that down rail into the flat bar. Switch up with a 450 out of that flat bar into the flat down. 270 on, 270 out, showing that he can spin in and out of all of the features. Coming in straight for that first jump. So 900 with a big Japan grab.
Squeaking that grab in there is so important. The judges are going to be noticing.
Switch 900 off the second jump. And on the final third jump, comes in with the double on the final jump.
Obviously bringing out his biggest trick for the last one right in front of the judges. That's what they want to see. They're going to be paying attention. I have no doubts he'll be able to improve on his other scores from his first two runs. But is it going to be enough to put him in contention with our leaders?
Having fun with those volunteers. So big 900 off that second. Coming in, switch into the second jump. Switch 900 tail grab. And off this bottom air.
When they're throwing so many variations into these tricks, whether they're taking off switch, spinning the opposite direction, as fluid as they make it look, it's so difficult and pushing their bodies in ways that it doesn't naturally want to go in. So really shows how the skill is there, but it takes that whole extra level to make it stylish and make it look good and make it look smooth and easy. And that's really what sets the top skiers apart from the others.
Yeah, it's effortless for these top skiers to go around twice in the air. That's a hard trick to do. And to make it look that easy, that's showing the judges where you need to be.
Great to see. He's going to be looking forward to a good score, hopefully, when they tally up the rail scores as well as the jumps at the bottom.
Having fun with the crowd on the chairlift there, getting some thumbs up. 79.91, a vast improvement from his 58.75.
That's what he was looking for. That puts him in the mix. That's the score. And you know what? He waited till his third and final run when the pressure was on to really come to play. And you know what? All smiles. He knows he did what he came here to do today.
All right. Alistair Murray, we have a Calgary local about to drop in.
So he skis for Winsport. This is the home field for him. That home field advantage is going to come into play for sure. He's 18 years old, but he still has a lot of experience. He knows this park. He knows these jumps. He knows these rails. And as much as they can be similar at different parks and different resorts, this is home hill for him.
Yeah, so we should see some good rail section for him with the gap in between those rails spinning. 450 off that big pyramid rail.
Choosing the more difficult route down with the pyramid and the teardrop, but having no problems. Nice and smooth with his rails.
Now let's see what Alistair has to offer on our jump line. So a flat spin 900 off that top air.
Landing switch, taking off and going for the 900 again.
Switch 900, very nice. Big muke grab. Oh, comes up a little short on his double on the bottom jump.
Just kind of missed that landing. Big trick, and he pulled it off, but definitely will be some points deducted there for Murray just for not quite sticking that last landing. But all in all, I think that was a successful run.
Yeah, you got to put it to your feet in this final run if you want to be in contention. But big 900s all around. And very big grabs. That's what the judges are looking for. Big definition showing that off.
I think he'll be happy. And obviously skiing in front of his hometown crowd, he's going to have family and friends there watching and cheering him on. And you know what? When you're going big off those bottom jumps, maybe he was a little too eager and just didn't quite have the speed.
Yeah, he knew he had to put it all on the line. He had some fall scores in those first two rounds, so he let it all go on his third round.
And speed's so difficult as snow changes. I mean, we've had a lot of mild temperatures here in Calgary. A lot of man-made snow at COP, but you know, they really have to be judging speed because landing where they want is going to be so important. And we have it a 46.91, so the judges definitely deducted some of his score from that missed landing on that last jump.
So that 46 shows that he made it all the way to that last jump. So they scored him all the way to there, but unfortunately, he just didn't put it to his feet. Next we have Jamie Meltron from USA.
One of the older competitors in the competition. He's 29 years old, and you know what? As much as the body's going to be taking its toll by that point, that's just years of experience. Let's see if he can use that to take take his previous scores, which were a little lower than I think he was expecting due to some of his mistakes. But if he can take that into a solid third run here, he'll be happy with the score at the end of the day.
So showing he can spin on and off the rails using the pyramid line and the teardrop. Coming in switch to his first hit. Switch 1080 off there into a switch double grab 900. So he was able to get both hands on two different skis. Into the double on the final jump, making it past that first blue line, but not quite going as large as a few others have gone for us today.
Didn't quite have the height, but you know what? Has the tricks, had the spins, had the grabs, and he's definitely happy with his performance. I think obviously coming off of two runs that he wasn't really thrilled with, I think we'll get a better score for him, and he can take that into the finals and see where that stacks up against our leaders.
That 1080 up top, very difficult maneuver. Three full spins into a switch 900. You can see he got his hands on both those skis as he comes around. Gets ready for that bottom air.
Yeah, might just not have had the speed there. He just didn't quite get the height, but he's got the grab in there and still stuck a clean landing, though.
Yeah, that's important. Getting to your feet. That's where you want to be.
Yeah. I didn't take the gym seriously when I was their age.
Awaiting his scores. He wants to improve upon that, and I have no doubts he'll be happy with what the judges are going to come up with.
Having a good time chatting it up with our volunteers. Can't say enough about how great it is to have this many volunteers to put on an event like this.
There's a lot of pieces of the puzzle to put on an event like this. Not only does it start from building a course with all the amount of snow that they need to create these huge jumps, but everyone from judges to hill prep to the organizing committee, it truly is a huge ordeal to put on a competition of this caliber, and it pays off because this is as top-tier world-class as competition gets, especially in slopestyle.
74.5.
That was the score.
Big improvement for him. He's got to be happy about that. You saw the fist pump. He's excited.
That's great to see.
So next up is Alex Hall, our current leader, with a 91.58 in his first run. He set the bar high.
Alex is only 17 years old. He's out of the USA. And you know what? He really stepped up in his first run with one of the scores to beat. 91.58 is a good score in any competition, but we've seen that as good as it gets here today. But you know what? Competition isn't over. He knows he's got some success in the bag already, but he wants to step it up.
And that's where you get those 91 scores. He had the 270 over the gap and then a 270 out, as well as 270 out of that flat bar. Showing great versatility on those rails.
He is not holding back in this third run at all. He is using everything he has to go for it, and he wants to beat that 91. Why not?
So switch 1080 tail grab, very smooth, very clean, into switch double 900, coming into the bottom jump. Into another double, so back-to-back doubles, showing he's got it.
That is the reason he is at the top of the leaderboard. That's awesome to see. He has the full package.
His top result to date is first at Rev Tour, which is a high-level competition. So he wants to continue with that.
Well, he's no stranger to winning, and you know if he's going to be bringing tricks like that out, he has the skills, the technical ability on the rails, showing he can spin both ways, and he was getting the height. Just look how far down the landings he was taking those big doubles.
Yeah, he has doubles in both directions, which most are just doing their straight spins in both directions. He is able to flip and spin in both directions.
And there's a reason that he's at the top of the leaderboard. We expect a lot from him after such a strong day already, but you know what? That was a solid third run. We might even see more out of him yet when the judges tally everything up.
And that's our judges right there, taking a look at things, getting ready for the next competitor.
And as we said, in a long course like this, it's a split panel where some judges will be judging the rails, obviously leading to their strengths and the technical ability. And he does it. 94.58. He stepped it up. That's what it takes to be a champion. That's what it takes to win a competition like this. And he took all the pressure into his third run, stepped up, and there it is. Paid off, 94.
Yeah, it wasn't an easy victory lap. It was push yourself all the way down, and it paid off for him, giving himself a little more of a cushion going for the rest of those competitors to try and catch him.
I think there's a reason he's been on the top of the podium before. If he can pull that full package of tricks out in a run like that, you got a lot of great success from him expected in the future.
Matthew Wilcox now on course. He's into that teardrop, 270 out. Coming into our first big air.
Successful in the rails. He's kept it smooth there. He's been consistent all day. He's had some great results from both his first two runs, and keeping that trend going here in the third.
So a big switch. Coming in, switch the final jump. Switch 1080, mute grab. Held the grab the entire spin.
That's amazing to see. Three rotations with the grab, taking off and landing backwards. That's a top-tier trick there, and that's paying off.
We've seen it takes two doubles to get to the top of the leaderboard, so we'll see where the 1080s can put Matthew Wilcox.
Yeah, not quite the level of difficulty we saw from the last competitor, getting those scores up into the 90s, but still tremendous jumps.
And it's not always about difficulty. Style has a lot to do with it, and that grab has a lot of style.
It's a full package. That's what it takes.
Another shot of our volunteers staying warm.
Got a little bit of wind picking up, as you can see there. It was pretty still to start, even though it won't change the athlete's tactics. It just might be something they're going to have to focus on to make sure they're consistent and know when they're getting the right speed and the right rotation and the right aim off those jumps.
Matthew Wilcox seems very happy right now. Just having a time at the bottom of that course.
That's what it's about, and he should be happy. He's got a score of 83, which is his best. He saved the best for last in his third round. He got his best score, 83.
And our final competitor now, Max Moffitt.
He's got the long hair flowing out. That's awesome to see. He's on our national development team, and he is a hometown hero here. This is his home hill. He knows this park. And our last competitor down the mountain is Max Moffitt.
Skating into that first flat bar, 270 on, 270 out.
One of our first skiers we've seen not use poles. I mean, it's definitely an option. It's all about style, and who knows if that's paying off. It's definitely a new, interesting style, and we've seen it more in the half pipe, but here we are, slope style, no poles.
Yeah, his first score is gonna hold up with a 90.91. Now he's just gonna go down and have some fun.
I think he knew that mistake's gonna cost him, so he's just gonna have fun with it, just like a day of skiing out with his buddies, because he knows that from here he's gonna bank on that first score from his first run, which was very solid. So he's gonna go with that today, but that keeps him in the mix.
Showing he can still spin both ways. He does back-to-back cork 360s into a nice 540 with a tail grab, just enjoying the sun and enjoying his time.
And he's still smiling, obviously. He knows he's got scores in the 90s to bank on. That keeps him in the mix. That keeps him not at the top of our leaderboard, but keeps him right in the mix. That's awesome to see from Max Moffitt.
Again, having fun out there, showing those shifties, doing those big cork 360s.
Well, we saw what it takes. It takes those double flips to really put you on the top of the leaderboard. Alex Hall brought it today. Obviously, the 17-year-old American has the experience and the style, because that score of 94.58 in his third run is what it took to be on the top of the podium today.
Nice to see those big ski jumps in the background. The 1988 legacy living on at COP.
I think that's one of the best things. These competitors at the start can be taking a quick look over to their right, seeing those Olympic rings, because they know that's their future. That's what they're striving for. They're looking for the X Games. They're looking for the World Cup. And now that slopestyle is an Olympic event, they want to represent Canada and go all the way to the top, right?
And having slopestyle as an Olympic event, that's really pushed the sport. Some of these new courses are amazing. We're going to see some great things. The Russian course in the 2014 Games was innovative, and the 2018 Games in Korea will be even crazier. And there you have it, our leaderboard. Alexander Hall with a 94.58 coming in first. Max Moffitt, strong showing with 90.91 for second place. And Matthew Wilcox with a very good 83.
Great to see our hometown heroes staying in the mix, using their experience, but it wasn't quite enough to beat the American Axel Hall today. Obviously, those double flips were what it took, and the judges responded with those tremendous scores, 94.58.
It was nice to see every athlete push it from their first runs. Nobody ended with a full-on fall score. Everybody put down at least one solid run.
Great to see everyone's healthy, although we had some bad crashes there. Everyone seemed to make it through, and that's what it's all about.
We go from these grommets all the way up to these amazing skiers. Nice to see.
Windsport definitely has the facility for any level. It's great to see everyone getting involved in the winter sport and be able to showcase some of what the potential can be in skiing right here in our own backyard at Canada Olympic Park.
Well, you get these mountains out there in your view, but sometimes you can't drive all the way to Banff, and Windsport definitely takes care of that need.
Well, that concludes our NORAM slopestyle competition at COP. For Kevin Kwasny, I'm Paul Stutz. Thank you for watching. This is Chasing Limits on Shaw TV, a glimpse into Alberta winter action sports and a look into the athletes and personalities that continue to chase their limits.